Welcome to VLearn. Today we start with application model, and in this model we have to discuss about the client and server architecture in which user interact with the number of devices which are connected on the system, which are connected on the server side. Client side always requests for the number of devices and number of resources, and server always get responses and always generate some responses in respect of client request to server from client. This process will continue till the client getting request and getting responses from the server. After closing this session, server get change the session and acknowledge to user to generate the new request and acknowledge to user the session is completed, your task is completed, now you can continue with the another query, otherwise session will be closed. In this, client node is represented at the left side and the server node is represented at the right side, in which a local memory is located at both end, in which they will store the content of the process, content of the task which they are executing and requesting from both end. Now object A and object B, there is a two objects which interact with the client program, and according to client, if there is any kind of object, any kind of resources is required, that is request from the server node, and it will get from the server to for processing or execution the new task. The same way, this is in the local object which requests in local manner, and if any object or any client request for server or request for any resource from beyond the range or beyond the domain as it requesting to server, then it is called the remote call. Now the next is application model, in which we discuss about the distributed shared memory, in which multiple users and multiple client, or you can say client server, sharing on the same memory locations, usually used for peer-to-peer communication instead of client server architecture, in which two devices are able to connect and communicate directly with each other on their respective protocols. Now client communicate with each other through shared variables, the system implement the illusion of shared memory and translate access to shared data into the appropriate messages. So the advantage is that it is really easy to program, hides all of the details of distribution, in which the disadvantage is that it often hides too much data from the both end, and it can be hidden surface, it can be abstract representation of content, in which it represent the number of notations as well number of features, number of advantages, number of disadvantages. Another disadvantage is that it is very complicated to implement a distributed shared memory system that works correctly and performs well. So the application model distributed shared memory that is represented here as a diagrammatical form, in which there is a number of nodes are able and they are able to communicate with the shared memory, and they are able to store or retrieve the content in this memory. They are accessing the content with the shared memory. This is the virtual memory and this is the local memory in respect of every node. So they can communicate and share the content according to virtual memory, and that is physically interact with this node, and in respect of the request from the node side, that will store into the proper local memory of respective request of a node. Now mutual exclusion in distributed system is kind of exclusion in which a number of processes are there and they are requesting for the same resource at the same time, then that kind of problem may be occur. And when all processes sharing a resource are on the same machine, mutual exclusion is easily assured by the use of semaphore. Semaphore is a solution or it kind of alternative option for the avoidance of deadlock, and you can say it is a solution of deadlock, spin lock or other similar shared abstractions. When the processes involved are on different machines, however, Mutual exclusion becomes more difficult because they are requesting from the different number of machine and requesting for the different number of resources. At the same time, if they are requesting for the same resource from the different number of nodes or from the remote login, then that kind of problem may be occurring. That should be required a kind of solution in which that kind of occur, that kind of problem will occur, then we have the solution. And we need to provide the solution for that kind of problem also. Now, mutual exclusion servers, in the printer example being used here, the problem of storage space in the spooler typically becomes acute with graphic printers. Suppose there is a single printer on a network and we are requesting and we are sending some request for generating printout and giving printing command to a single printer from n number of computers, then there is a spooler which makes the sequence makes a kind of structure in which it accepts the request first in first out process, that is a kind of queue process in which it maintains a queue and generate the results and generate the output in respect of the priority request which we send, or we can say the command given according to the sequence, and it will also give the same sequence the outputs in a hard copy format. Send request for permission to the spooler, await reply giving permission to print, loop, send data directly to printer, and loop, because data is received by the printer and it will generate outputs in a form of paper printout. So if all user of the spooler use this protocol, the spooler is no longer serving as a spooler. It merely serving as a mutual exclusion mechanism, because it is going to resolve the problem of mutual exclusion. In this case, we have the number of options to provide the users for generating the printout. When we need to share a single resource on a network, then we need to given a particular time slot given to particular sequence to every node for giving the command or request to a single shared resource. That's why that resource can work efficiently on the network. Next is token-based mutual exclusion. One alternative to the mutual exclusion server is to arrange the competing process in a ring and let them exchange a token. They are able to share the resources in a number of process by sharing the token and exchanging the data and resources between them. So this is the token based mutual exclusion, in which they are accepting some token from other process and generating or allocating resource to that process. So they have a solution by token, but in some kind this token feature is also get failed when we are getting requesting and receiving the number of tokens from the more than one devices and we need to allocate the number of resources to both the devices. If that resource is the same which is requested by both the devices, so we have some problem. We are not able to allocate same resource to multiple devices or processes at the same time. So this is the exact software analog of a token ring network. In a token ring network, only one process at a time may transmit and the circulating token is used to assure this. If we are not going to assure that kind of request, then we still face the mutual exclusion problem. Token based mutual exclusion, token holder has a right to access shared resource. In the process which is holding a token and which have token and have the sequence of getting the resource, it can share the memory and the number of resources which are available in a sharing mode, wait for ask for token, enter critical section where it is obtained, pass to another process on exit or hold until requested. Hold it till the another process get request for that, otherwise exit from that process and release the resource which is occupied by that particular process for executing their commands. If a process receives the token and does not need it, just pass it on. This is also kind of condition need to apply in the number of processes when they are executing some process. If any process is not required any resource which is occupied by itself, then it should release that particular resource because it can be required and it can be requested by the another resource. If we follow that kind of format or process for allocation of resources and using of resources, then there may be we can avoid, and there maybe we are able to avoid the kind of deadlock or critical section problem. Now, token based mutual exclusion, there is some advantages, and if anything have some advantages, then it is also having some disadvantages in this scenario. Starvation can be avoided by efficient organization of the process, by sharing the resources, by applying that token ring, by applying the time slot for every process. Deadlock is also avoidable by using that kind of techniques which we discussed in previous slides. Deadlock is a kind of condition in which we cannot follow, and kind of deadlock is not occur due to single condition. There is a four or five conditions. If all condition occur simultaneously, then the deadlock will occur. Disadvantage: token loss. Must initiate a cooperative procedure to recreate the token, and also must ensure that only one token is created and allocate only a single token to a particular process for request of new resources. This is an algorithm like Lamport's Becquerel algorithm, in which envision a Becquerel with a numbering machine at its entrance, so each customer is given a unique number when they are going to execute and perform their task. Like we are going for some product service at a service center, then we are getting some token number, and we can go on particular sequence, and we can take the services for particular product, and we can come back. And this is the sequence in which we can get the number of tokens, and same process if we follow for allocating the resources to number of process, if we also follow the token sequence and token for you can say maintaining the queue for allocation of resources, then we can somehow resolve that kind of critical section problem also. According to the analogy, customers are threads identified by the letter I. You can say the iteration of number of sequence which we allocated, or you can say the number of tokens allocated to the number of processes obtained from a global variable. Due to the limitation of computer architecture, some parts of Lamport analogy need slight modification according to the requirement of allocation of a number of resources to number of processes. It is assumed that the thread identifier I is also a priority, in which basis we are going to process the number of tasks. A lower value of I means a higher priority, and threads with higher priority will enter the critical section first and execute it first. Now, Lamport's Becquerel algorithm also says there is the sequence algorithm provide a decentralized implementation of the take a number idea, in which it can be allocated or requested for the number of processes, number of resources according to their requirement, and get the sequence number for their execution. Now, this is the process by which they execute the process. This is the process. I is not in the Becquerel. I has picked a number and is in the Becquerel. Same way, process I is not trying to pick a number, process I is trying to pick a number. These are the scenario when the number of processes are there, they are trying to access the number, sequence number, and they are not trying to access the sequence number because some processes are near to completion, they are not requesting for new resources, and some processes are in a entrance stage, or you can say the initial stage. So they require the number of resources, they are requesting for a particular resource sequence, they will get that sequence number and will execute their task in a particular sequence which is they allocated or which they having the token number. So Ricard and Agrawal mutual exclusion algorithm, in this, based on multicast, when the single process is allocated and used by the multitasking process and used by the multi-programming sense, in which processes requesting access multicast request to all other processes. So process may only enter critical section if all other processes return positive acknowledgement messages. As on that basis, assumptions are also there when we are executing and processing number of processes. All processes have communication channels to all other processes as well. They are able to interact and communicate with the devices and communicate with the number of resources which are available for the task. So All processes have distinct numeric ID and maintain logical clocks according to they have the sequence number, and the system or operating system is able to create the offset number, which is process getting which one resource and which resource is allocated to which one process, and the sequence number of allocation of number of resources as well. So we can say Ricard Agrawal's mutual exclusion algorithm is also initialized by some number of sequences in which initialized the initial state and which is released when the new process will get enter into the system, that is multicast request to all processes when number of processes enter into the system for execution and they are requesting for number of resources. They will wait until the reply received, and if they get the resource, it will come inside the held state in which they are having the resources, and they are entering into the held and wanted state, held representing which resource they are having and wanted represent which resource they require for execution, and accordingly it will process and exit only when they will entering into the critical section. If they are entering into the critical section, we are exiting from the system and release the number of processes which are causing for critical section, and again they will enter into the system from the beginning and till end it will get executed. Ricard and Agrawal mutual exclusion algorithm. In this algorithm by Ricard and Agrawal, if request is broadcast and state of all other processes is released when they are having the completion of resources and they completed already their execution task, so they will release and then all process will reply immediately and requester will obtain entry and try to enter into the system for execution of the number of new processes. If at least one process is in state held, that process will not reply until it has left critical section, hence mutual exclusion will exist there. So if two or more processes request at the same time, whichever process request bears lower timestamp will be the first to get n minus 1 replies, or you can say they are getting the reply and responses according to that and get for execution of number of resources for execution or completion their task. In respect of request, in case of equal timestamp are there, process with lower ID will get win and they will get the resource for execution. The same, this is the P1, P2, P3 process. If P1 having the higher priority, they will get the process and it require the lesser time for execution, it will get the resource for execution. If P1 and P3 and P2, everybody having the same priority and same timestamp for execution, then the first request will get executed first. It will execute or process the task on the basis of first come first serve basis. If every process required the same timestamp for execution or completion their task in that system, this is also required. Agrawal's mutual exclusion algorithm, in which number of steps are defined. P3 not attempting to enter, P1 and P2 request entry simultaneously, P3 replies immediately. So this is the process which we discussed in the previous slide, in which it requests for the process, it getting response from that process for allocation or requesting a new resource. Same way they all are requesting for number of resources. You can see here P2 is a process which is requesting for 34 number process from P1 and P3 as well. Simultaneously is requesting for the same process from both processes, requesting for the same resource from both processes, and it is also having the same process. Means if we are going to allocate the same process or same resource to this process at the same time, then it will get and it may cause a critical section problem, because it is also having the same resource and requesting the same resource from multiple processes, then it may lack of the availability of 34 number resource in the system. So it's all. Thank you so much. Now this is the last unit of your course content. This is the remote processor core. When we are trying to access some content from a system which is not in our local network, and somebody trying to access a particular system from a remote location or from a distance, then you can say it is required a remote processor core for accessing the content, accessing the system processor. In the same way, we have some sequences. In introduction, remote processor call is a high level module For client-server communication, it provides the programmers with a familiar mechanism for building a distributed system in which multiple users are in a network, but they are not in the same network. They are logging in or accessing the content from some remote location, from some remote area. Then they required for a remote processor call for accessing the file or content on that particular system, which is not in the proper local network. So, example file service and authentication service, which is not in particular system, that kind of services always try to access from the remote login or remote processor call. Why we need remote processor call? The same way, the client needs an easy way to call the processor of the server to get some services or to get some new resources or to get some specific accesses on the particular content by retrieving some information from that system on the requirement basis. RPC enables client to communicate with server by calling processor in a similar way to the conventional user processor calls in high level languages also exist in this system. RPC is modeled on local processor call, but the call processor is executed on different process and usually different computer, which is not on same network, which is too far away from the existing system. That in that situation we require the RPC call. How to operate RPC? When a process on a machine A calls a processor on machine B, the calling process on A is suspended and the execution of the call processor takes place on B. As we are requesting for some process or some task from the system A and that request pass on to the process or system B, then the request is executed and processed by the system B in replacement of the system A. The same way we can call the another processor as well. Information can be transported from the caller to the calling in the parameters and can come back in the processor results. And you can take it the live example in that scenario when we have to share some information with another person on voice call, then that particular person is also able to share some content at their end. So if it is and that person from that machine sharing some information and data in the same way, means both persons are able and also sharing some information and content from both hand. That is the also example of this scenario. No message passing or input output at all is visible to the programmer as well. So RPC model is there. Call processor and wait for reply. This is the client which requests to server for particular process or particular resource. A server will respond to particular client in respect of its request. So it is the blocking state in which the client is waiting for the response of the server. In that particular scenario, it will not going to do any task. It is waiting for the response from the server side. If it get response from server, then it will continue for execution and for their processing number of tasks for which it is requesting to the server. And this is a blocking state which is represented with the green dots. And this is the state in which it is executing the state or processing the request of the user or client. The call processor is in another process which may reside in another machine. The process do not share address space. Parameters are passed by values which we shared or execute inside the system. The called remote processor execute within the environment of the server process as well. When we are executing and processing the number of tasks on that particular system, the same way the call processor does not have access to the calling processor environment where it is accessing or providing the support for content and information in RPC call. These are the number of features. Simple call syntax, it is very familiar to the user. Familiar semantics, no much rules and regulation or protocols are there for establishment of communication. Well-defined interface already from sender and from receiver. Ease of use, can easily communicate with the following of some messages or following of some communication process. Efficiently, we can deliver or receive the number of messages on the same network as well. Can communicate between process on the same machine or different machines, also having some features for representation and sharing of data and information. If it is sharing the data and information on the same network, then it is possible with the LAN. And if it is sharing some data or information on different network, then we need some networking devices for implementation of a communication link or connection between two different networks and for sharing the data and information between that networks from where they are communicating to each other, caller and callee as well. These are the limitations for this scenario. Parameters passed by value only and pointer value are not allowed in this system. Remote processor calling and return time overheads can be significantly 1 to 3 order of magnitude slower than that for local processor as compared to remote processor calling. When we are calling from another location, then we have the options for generating messages, for getting messages, but it is as compared to local system getting some slow responses. This may affect real-time design and the programmer should be aware of its impact as well. And these are the limitation for RPC. RPC is more vulnerable to failure since it involves communication system and it is calling from and it is connecting from different remote location, and there is the lot of constraints are there, the network availability, the communication establishment link and the distance, very restrictive constraints on RPC call, and another machine is compatible or not with the communicating machine as well. The programmer should be aware of the call semantics. Programs that makes use of RPC must have the capability of handling number of errors which are occurring inside the system, inside the local network, and that can be resolved with the processor calls from the RPC or LPC. LPC stands for local processor call. When we are networking establishment or communicating connection establishment with the same network, and if we are networking or establishment of communication from the different location or remote location, then the RPC call will work inside the system. Then these are the design issues in which exception handling necessary because of possibility of network and nodes failure may be occur in the system. RPC uses return value to indicate errors and transparency representing syntactic achievable, exactly the same syntax as a local processor call for RPC call. So there can be miscommunication or misguide to establishment of connection with another or RPC location or RPC machine from where it is communicating or establishing the connection for sharing the data or information into the network. And delivery guarantees. Retry request message. Whether to retransmit the request message until either a reply or the server is assumed to have failed may be the problem kind. Maybe that kind of problem may be occur into the system for transmitting the messages or communication between the two or more than two networks in the environment of communication. Now, the another is duplicate filtering, in which we have to find out the duplicate messages on the network, which making the generating some errors on the network, and they are the cause of the overloading of the network into the system. Retransmission of replies, whether to keep a history of reply messages to enable lost replies to be transmitted without re-executing the server operations into the network when they are sharing the data or information. This is the RPC mechanism in which client computer and server computer in front of us. So the client representing at the local environment and server is execute processor. When we are executing the number of tasks, we have to request to server and it will generate some responses in respect of our request. This is the sequence when local call is generated, that passing from the send request or martial argument to the execute processor, receive request and then martial argument, and accordingly it will generate some responses for the user that will come from the execute processor and send reply and the local local return messages in their client stub as well. So communication module representing some information which is local machine or client machine generating messages to server machine, and server also responding with respect of client messages to user or client machines. RPC mechanism, in which the client provides the argument and calls the client stub in the normal way. The client stub builds a message and traps to operating system and network kernel, in which it try to find out the error and causes which are occurring into the system when they are communicating in different networks. The kernel send the messages to the remote kernel as well. Remote kernel receives the message and gives it to the server dispatcher, and accordingly it generates the responses, and in the same server from kernel it goes to the client as well. The dispatcher select the appropriate server stub as well, and the same way client also select the dispatch way and for sending or receiving the messages at both end. In this mechanism, the server procedure does the work and returns the result to the server stub. The server stub packs it in message and call return and traps it to operating system and network kernel as well. The remote receiver kernel sends the messages to the client kernel. The client kernel gives the messages to the client stub, and this is the number of procedure which they follow for implementation of communication between the system. Between the procedure of RPC call, they are able to communicate and share the data and information by following this number of steps and this number of sequences. By after that, they can close the communication, they can close the session which they establish for communication into the system. So same way, RPC implementation, there is a three main task: interface processing, communication handling and binding. In interface processing, it provides the interface for client and server. By that way, they are able to communicate, and by that way they can establish the communication in a compatible way. Communication handling, transmitting and receiving request and reply messages from both ends. Binding, location and appropriate server for a particular service, for representation of that service, for establishing the communication. RPC implementation represent the interface processing as well, marshalling and unmarshalling of argument which they are requesting by passing the number of parameter or argument into the request. In respect of the client, server is also responding the same way and providing the same message from the server side with the parameters. This is the request of client and this is the response of server. That is almost similar, and almost similar parameters they have, but there is a difference. It represents the client, it represents the server side responses from the procedure. RPC implementation use the signature of the procedure in the interface to generate marshalling and unmarshalling operation as well into the communication system. Generate procedure headings for each procedure in the service from the interface definition, in which it has the TCP/UDP communication for easy to make it easy for transmission of communication or sending or receiving the messages over the network. And next one is the socket programming, in which they can communicate or establish the communication connection on the basis of a switching technique. Socket programming help them to communicate or establishment of the connection from one device to another device for sharing the data and information over the network. In binding, it binds the number of communication or communicating IDs into the communication system, where they are able to communicate or share the data and information at both level. Binding is important because an interface definition specifies a textual service name for use by client and server. In the same way, they are able to send the messages and request messages at both port, client port and server port, for sharing the data and information. RPC implementation represent the binder, a separate service that maintain a table containing mappings from service name to server port where they are sending or receiving the messages. All other service depend on the binder service. Binder interface used by server is registered string name, port name, number or server. It versioning also there, and this is a register and this is a withdraw. The same process is followed at the server side for transferring the information, and the same kind of request or parameters followed for the client as well, and the responses for the server and requesting from the client, the same sequences followed as we discussed in the previous slide. Other middleware technologies about the object request broker, which we discussed in the yesterday or previous class, distributed computing environment, in which we discuss about the communication between two or more than two devices, which establishing some session and sending one message to more than one devices on the same time on the same system as well. Message oriented middleware, in which they are communicating the messages on the basis of texture, on the basis of some multimedia, in data sharing on the client server, on the RPC call processor as well. COM/DCOM are the processor component object model and distributed component object model, or you can say the transmission system which they followed in the communication system at the kernel level. Transaction processing monitor technology is also followed there for processing the number of transactions which commit and some are not able to commit. If some process or transaction is able to commit, then we can recover it. If any transaction is not going to commit any checkpoint, then that kind of transaction should be start from the beginning. There is a three tier software architecture also discussed in the previous or in the previous classes as well, in which they are able to communicate with both hands for developing or for completing the process. So this course is completed, and thank you so much.